Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, Billy. It's a full house tonight. I've got four people involved in what could be the strangest episode of the SWN Podcast, as I am joined by three trainees from Joe Hendry's Edinburgh Wrestling School Academy. It's called both things website, so it could be either. We're joined by Major Matt Wolfe, who is to the right of me, or left on this video. I've got Fletch Cassidy in the diagonal, and I've got Mister Manoval down below me. So, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having us.
Thank you.
So, we've kind of set this up really in the aftermath of our Twitter tournament, which you guys were—I think you guys were three of the final four. You're definitely all round by the last lot. And then Fletch contacted me when I was doing a call out for episodes, and here we are. We're going to do everyone in a way. And so just to let everyone know that's listening and watching to this now, we'll do individual episodes with each. So we'll get their full story or a little bit more about them, because Zoom has a 40-minute limit. So we're our 4-minute limit, and it could go all wrong from there. So we're going to do the Facebook questions. We've got a quiz coming up, which I'm so excited about because I worked really hard on it. I tried to get the person who's the subject of to send in something, but unfortunately he's far too busy, which is understandable because he is like the busiest man in wrestling at the moment, even with a lockdown and pandemic. And we might have a big finish. Let's see how we go. I should let you guys introduce yourself. That would make sense. So again, we'll start for every order. I'm just going to just go Matt, Fletch, Mr. Manoval. I can't remember if I even introduced you yet. So we'll just start from there and then go around. So who's joining us today?
I'm Major Matt Wolfe.
Fletch?
What an intro.
Too good.
I've done that, by the way. That's that. I can't top that.
I can't top that. I'm sorry. I am Big Red Fletch Cassidy, the youngest of the three of the students of Joe Hendry in this call.
And finally?
And I'm Mr. Manoval, and I believe I will be the latest addition to the managerial side of Scottish wrestling.
And the man who has possibly the creepiest promos in Scottish wrestling right now. Although that is saying something when I've seen Fletch's as well. They're a little scary.
Yeah.
So went to Facebook about the call for questions, and they came in. There's loads. There's absolutely loads. So we'll just start from the top and work our way down from my list I have here. Some are about wrestling. Some definitely art about wrestling. Some are just terrifying thoughts of the mind. So we'll start right from the top with Daniel Cherry. He sent in three. We've got, hey people, how much do social... Daniel Cherry has kind of screwed the pooch here with the grammar. Hey people, how much do social media affect new up and coming wrestlers? How much does social media affect the up-and-coming wrestlers nowadays? Now, you guys have obviously not been able to wrestle, so social media is your way of getting your characters across. So, like I said, we'll start with the round table. Matt, how have you found social media has helped you get your character across and get your name out there?
As you said, so far, like with no actual shows for us to have had that full debut, it's been good to sort of slowly build our own little world within the world of Scottish wrestling, and you know, social media has been key to just getting the names out there, taking risk with promos, stuff like that.
Is it Fletch and add to that?
Matt said, just with everything that's happened, obviously we haven't been able to wrestle, and promos have just been, you know, the only way that we can really get ourselves over without actually being on shows per se. And so far, hopefully it stays this way, it's been going pretty well. It's been going decently.
Absolutely. And Manoval?
So the question was, how does it affect you, right?
Well, it says, well, the question was, how much do social media affect new up-and-coming wrestlers nowadays? There could have been a couple commas in there somewhere, but yeah.
Cool. So it's like, I wouldn't say how it affects you. I think it's how it enables you. Because it's without being able to wrestle or have like a live show or anything with that, it's like what Matt was just touching on there was building a world. It's, we're brand new. Let's not like beat about the bush here. Nobody knows who we are, and so the only way to get a name out there and sort of invite people into these characters is through social media. So it's like you've had to like all the stuff we were doing in training almost got thrown out. Well, not thrown out the window, but put to the wayside. And it's like, right, you've got to now introduce these characters. Now the real hard work begins. And social media was the biggest platform that we had available for that. So we just had to baptize with fire, dive right in.
Absolutely. I mean, I think it's very fitting that you come from Joe Hendry School, because he's very much, I mean, he's a fantastic wrestler. That's absolutely a fact. But the fact that he got his start really was through the character work. He does the songs, he does everything like that. Was just to divert from that for a second, was that something that he tried to instill in you when all this lockdown was happening, was get your name out, get your character out, and then once we can start training again, we'll get the rest sorted, kind of thing? Anyone?
Yeah,
100%. Oh, you go first, Matt. On you.
Oh, okay.
I was going to say 100%. I don't want to divulge too much about Joe's training and his approach to stuff or anything like that, but it was definitely a big point of this is your, it was all about, so the positive aspect of this is a negative thing for most people. How do you turn this into your positive? What do you have control of and what can you do? And the hard part of that was, right, we've got to work on these characters. Who are you? What does that look like? And how do you present that? Essentially in an online way. I mean, everyone's been thinking about how they're going to be presenting their characters in a live show, and then boom, gone. You don't have that for the foreseeable future. And Joe was a massive proponent in getting us to think about how do you present yourself online and build that character and build that world and how to kind of engage with an audience online.
Absolutely. That's the best way for it. So continue with Daniel's questions here. He's got, how do you find training at your school? Anyone wants to jump in?
I hate the guys.
So far, I think the biggest thing I've found since starting training is the gymnastics side of things. Flinging yourself at the floor and doing like a diving forward roll I'm 31. And obviously when you started training earlier this year, at 31 I shouldn't be able to flip myself over my own head, but I can now. So it's strange things that my body I didn't think could do, but it's learning pretty quickly.
Excellent. Anyone else?
I'd have to say, like, from starting training, it's given me a whole new level of respect to what people were doing before and how they get to that physical conditioning, because like I don't, like the other guys, I've done sports in other aspects, but when it comes to that conditioning and that resilience that you need, it was like a new level that I'll admit for the first session, I was not ready for. It totally blew my mind about what was going to be not expected. I knew it was kind of what was going to be expected, but how that would feel. For anyone who's thinking, oh yeah, I want to get into this, whatever you think, oh, is this going to be hard? It's harder. So prepare you.
So Fletch, you've got youth on your side in this panel. So did you find that to be an advantage at all?
I mean, yeah. Although I've been training for what will be 3 years. When it gets to February, it'll be 3 years since I started training. I think it would have been probably. And since then, I've just both grown as a person, both mentally and physically. That's what wrestling does to you. As for the actual training and all that, like, it's Jamie Manoval put it perfectly. Like, he put it perfectly. If you think it's hard, way harder. But you get used to it eventually.
Excellent. Maybe the young ones do.
Yeah. I might just be saying that for myself.
So Daniel's last question that he put through is, we've got one that's kind of similar and it's kind of a big question, so we'll leave it towards the end. So we'll go to Brody Adler next, who of course has had run-ins with most of you during our Twitter tournament during that time, just due to witchingness. I think that's the kind of description we can call it that. She's sent through a similar strange question. She's put, where would a giraffe wear a bow tie, scarf and collar with a tie? Would it be like under the chin, or would it be at the bottom of the neck?
I didn't
if
see that.
If anyone wants to take a stab at that.
Well, I would say it depends on the type of giraffe or what the giraffe is feeling at the time. Maybe they're actually, like, you know, quite keen on their neck. Maybe they want to show that off and they don't want it, like, they want to bring the, you know, the attention lower. So they might wear it near the bottom and then people are like, oh, that's a nice neck. And then look up and they're like, that's a great neck. Maybe they're trying to seduce one of the other giraffes, and or maybe they're more into their face. So they have it a little bit higher and they go, oh, that's a nice bow tie. Oh, nice face as well. That's what I would do if I was a giraffe.
Any advances on that?
I was honestly going to say at a party. you mean like some sort of Roald Dahl party with a giraffe wearing a bow tie?
We've had a very serious answer so far and an amazing answer. You got to settle this then, Fletch, what have we got?
I need to reread this. Where would a giraffe wear a bow tie, scarf, and collar with tie? I'll be honest, I would have said something similar to what Matt said.
Oh, really? I was thinking, like, where would they wear it on their neck? But when Matt said it at a party, I was like, oh, yeah.
But, yes, I would say, like, where geographically they would they would wear them, you know, going out for something to eat. I don't know. Going to one of the big trees.
Going to the theater. A giraffe theater.
Where on their body? I wouldn't say a way up at their head. I would say, you know, at the bottom of their neck. I don't know why I did that. That's awfully
weird. Sorry, I'm sure someone won't give it and use it forevermore.
I guarantee that'll be the case.
Brody finished with a wrestling question, which, I know it's a wrestling podcast, we should really do some wrestling questions. She's put, dream matches of any wrestler, live or dead, why and what stipulations? So fastest thought first.
What, ourselves or like?
Yeah. Who would you want to face?
Oh, right. Okay. I'll let these guys go first.
Christian.
Oh, nice.
For me, growing up, I was a big fan of Christian, a big fan of Matt Hardy. Always a fan of the lesser star of a tag team. And obviously, Jeff, kind of, when they first started, was bigger than Matt. But when Christian went to TNA, that, for me, was more significant than Kurt Angle going to TNA. And I would just think you could just have any sort of match with Christian, and you know it would be solid.
Yeah, he's famed for his stamina as well, so you'd have to have your working boots on. Yeah, anyone else?
I'd say a dream match for me has and always will be. I know, like, people always choose their, you know, favorite wrestlers of all time, so I will stick with that. I'll say Shawn Michaels. Like, I just think, like, and as for a stipulation, just a dog standard one-on-one match. I just think, because Shawn Michaels, his in-ring ability is just unbelievable. And I think I could learn a thing or two from a match with him. I know he's, like, not as able in-ring as he was in his prime. But if I had the choice, I would choose Shawn Michaels in his prime versus Big Red Fletch Cassidy. Bog standard one-on-one match. It would be a massive learning experience.
And finally, well, Mr. Manoval, you said you're the managerial side. So we can turn this on the head a little bit and just say, if you had to manage someone, what would be your dream person to manage?
It would be Mankind, circa sort of 96, 97. Basically, I want to be Paul Bearer. Like, I want to be him at that time. It was, like, for personal reasons, he was the sort of guy that we'll probably get into later on, but the reason for that is he has influenced pretty much a lot of my decisions in terms of creativity with that, but we can get into it later. In terms of the stipulation, if I was to be managing for a match, it's got to be either a buried alive or just a straight up no disqualification. It's got to be something absolutely mental that he would...
I don't know why I can imagine this, though. I can see you'd imagine someone in a Kennel from Hell match. I mean, I don't know why it pops into my mind, but I just think that would be... they've only had one, and I think that's a crying shame.
For another. Yeah.
Need more of them. So we've got Bryce Kitcher. I hope I've said that right. He's put, hey guys, who are your favourite wrestlers growing up? Do you use these as influences for your characters, or do you draw that from someone else? So, favourite influence.
You want to go, Matt?
Yeah, I'll go. For me, I mean, obviously, I've already mentioned Christian, Matt Hardy, people like that. I was a huge fan of Nigel McGuinness. My first ever live show was Ring of Honor's first show, and it's him, Daniel Bryan, Pure Title Unification. And I just remember meeting him after and being like, you are the biggest man I have ever seen in the flesh. And at that point, I think I was 16, 17, and already I was pretty tall. I still remember looking up at Nigel McGuinness. And I think from there, I've taken aspects with certain namage, and that kind of reflects that.
Yeah, Fletch.
Favorites growing up, as well, growing up.
still in growing.
Yeah. I mean, I've been watching wrestling since before I was even 2 years old. At WrestleMania 20 was my first show.
You made us just feel all old.
So. I'm sorry. So I would say, you know, you've got your Triple H, definitely. The long hair was just, I don't know why he shaved it. He still is one of my favorites of all time. He was like my first ever favorite wrestler. I mean, then I started, you know, with Shawn Michaels and everything. But then there's like, I was a really big fan of The Big Show growing up. Really big fan. No real reason. Big I just fan. Really, I what?
Said big fan.
Big fan. Yes. I can't really think of others. I mean, I've been a big fan of a lot of people from like even before I was born. Sorry for making you feel old again. The Attitude Era. I'm a massive fan of a lot, like Stone Cold Steve Austin. He is my, I would say, second favorite of all time. I do take, I take a fair bit of influence from my favorites, but most of the people I take influence from are like, you know, just current wrestlers, more current wrestlers, like, who would be a good, oh, I say current. Kane would be one. He's not current. He's the mayor now. He's a mayor now, so it's not current. he's probably one of the biggest influences I have. Daniel Bryan's another one. There you go. Daniel Bryan.
Promo style be like a bit of Bray Wyatt, bit of that kind of thing.
Yeah, I was just about to say Bray Wyatt as well. Bray Wyatt specifically, like as he was transitioning to the Fiend, sort of. Not like, well, sort of before the Firefly Funhouse stuff, like, but just before that, and like when he was, you know, the Wyatt family guy. Yeah, I take my promo style mostly from him, I would say, because I feel like he is and still is one of the best promo guys in wrestling, like, ever, I would say. I would go as far to say that. And I just take, you know, bits and pieces from his, well, not bits and pieces, I take influence from his promos as much as I can. Mankind as well, like Jamie said, his promos, Mick Foley's in general, his promos, just second to none. Like, they're just unbelievable. And I would say that I take a lot of, like, you know, my voices, well, I say voices, a lot of my, what's the
nuances.
Word?
Nuances. Or
yeah, there you go.
Reflections.
Yeah, I take a lot of that from him, from Mick. And yeah. Just
So for questions, anything about wrestlers, I'm assuming it's going to be managers for you, Manoval.
Not necessarily.
No? Okay.
No. Like, to be honest, a lot of the managers I like. It's the aesthetic and the choices, the character choices that I tend to go for. So in terms of, I think, being the older one, so I'm 32, and the characters that I don't know what it says about, like, an 8-9-year-old thinking this is so cool. But again, it was the Mankinds, it was the Canes, it was the Undertakers and the Brood. Like, that sort of thing I was drawn to as a 9-year-old, which is, I think, quite odd, because you're like, oh, those are, like, the more sort of scary guys. But those are the ones that sort of influenced the decisions that I'm making just now. And I know that people go to their childhood and that sort of nostalgic feeling and generally maybe try to recreate that. And yeah, I'd say those are the ones that Fletch, you've covered Mankind and Kane quite a bit, so I don't want to run over that old ground again. But what I want to try with you take that, the Mankinds and all that, and what I want to try and ingest with Mr. Manoval is this feeling of sort of mischievous and a bit of fun, but in almost like a Rob Zombie House of a Thousand Corpses type way. And how do you marry those two together? But in terms of the favorite wrestlers, it's those guys there, the Mankind, Kane, Undertaker, and it's got to be The Rock as well. Like, you don't go into wrestling without seeing The Rock and going, he is the coolest guy, and just owning everything.
And I could also see when Fletch is going on about the Bray Wyatt just before the Firefly Funhouse, but from your promos, I can definitely see the Firefly Funhouse bit of it, the uneasiness, the fun-loving, but there's just a little undercurrent of uneasiness as well.
I would never try to even say that I'm on even remotely the same sort of plane as Bray Wyatt and what he's doing with that stuff, because, like, no one else in wrestling is doing anything like that. People lost their minds when it came out, because, like, they hadn't seen this kind of stuff before. It was that attention to detail and making them feel uneasy, and you could show that to a non-wrestling fan and they'd be like, what is that? They are genuinely interested in that. So if you even put me in that comparison, then thank you.
I'm sure we'll dive into that again in our probably her one-on-one interview in the future. Got a couple more weird ones. So Bryce has got, would you rather fight 100 Rey Mysterio sized Khalis or one Kali-sized Rey Mysterio? I mean, between either of them, right, there's at least one knee. So,
but clearly, the many, mini Kalis.
That's a lot of, like, think of that guy smashing at your knee. Especially,
that's a lot of chops.
You see how quickly he moves? I could deal with 100.
100?
Yeah.
You can deal with 100 of them.
100
slow-moving great colors.
Yeah. One massive Rey Mysterio.
Exactly. I would take the massive Rey Mysterio. Absolutely.
As well.
Yeah.
There's one.
No, I can see both sides of this. Yeah, I mean, you can, if 100, I mean, you've got to remember, this is Great Khali, who took about 10 hours to walk to the ring. I mean, he's not the quickest moving. Imagine that as, well, Rey Mysterio's not that quick anymore, but you could imagine a Khali-sized Rey Mysterio doing a 619. That would just be...
Yeah. Yeah, it'd be terrifying, but you've only got one guy to think of. 100. You've got 100 of these guys. If you're dealing with 100
is a big number.
That is a big number. I think you're underestimating the volume of
number 100.
And the other weird one we've got outside of the dinosaur question, which we'll get to, is out of the three of you, who could last 3 minutes with Bonesaw?
So 3 minutes of
playing time.
3 minutes. Not me, first of all. You know what? Sorry, Matt. I'm going to go with Fletch.
What? I think me and Mr. McGraw could have a good
slugfest. If I survive.
Well, you just got to get through 3 minutes. I mean, if you beat him within one, then you only get a third of the prize money. This has already been documented.
End in a draw.
Major Matt Wolfe would be decimated in 30, less than that. Probably would get to the ring.
I have Chester. I could just whack Mr. McGraw with the with Chester and he'd be done. There. Don't even need the 3 minutes. Give me 10 seconds.
Right. Like I say, if you don't last the 3 minutes, you're getting a portion of the prize money, so bear that in mind. We've also got Johnny Reeves, again with the oddest things, which is maybe super easy to read. Would you rather have toes where your fingers should be or fingers where your toes should be?
Fingers where your toes should be.
Yeah.
I feel like I look too much like a monkey.
You
get thumbs, though. You get thumbs. I'm assuming we're getting thumbs here if we're doing that.
Yeah, we'd be
climbing
trees and doing all sorts. If we
have
toes, it'd be useless.
Yeah. All right, okay. Yeah. It just makes... Oh, we've lost Fletch. We'll come
we
back.
Hated that question. Sure, knew he couldn't last 3 minutes.
We'll go with the dinosaur question and see if he comes back in the meantime. So, of course, our long time... So that Bonesaw question was from Kevin Williams. He's also asked his standard question. He just put a GIF, but I know what it is. Is who's your favorite? Well, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Crocodile. It's still going. Like, it's prehistoric and it's still here. Survival of the fittest.
Correct. Cool. Crocodile.
I mean, mine's I like the pterodactyl. Oh, you know, that's a lie. I like this because of the dispute amongst the name for it. But I've been told it's pronounced Diplodocus, but I've also been told it's Diplodocus.
I'll go Diplodocus, personally. Right, Fletch is back.
My laptop ran out on me. I hate the thing. I mean, the charger's broke, so I couldn't charge it, so now I'm on my phone. So it'll be a lot more portable.
Hashtag pray for laptop.
I know, it's not even mine, it's my dad's. Because mine is slower.
So we've asked, what's your favourite dinosaur? We've got crocodile, Diplodocus.
I'll go for the... I don't know.
We've had some interesting answers in the past, including Rex from Toy Story. Barney.
That's my answer. That is my answer, Rex.
Barney.
I'm sure we've had Barney. We've had the ones from Land Before Time. We've had some very strange answers, but now vote for X. So while we've still got you, then we'll just dive into the thing I worked on the most. Actually, no, we've got one more question on Twitter, which I think needs to be answered, is from the Supreme Ryan Richards. How does it feel to have the privilege of attending the same wrestling school as a Supreme?
My GIF says it all.
We don't even answer that guy. We don't even give him a response.
No. Wait, we could say.
I've said it before. I'll say it again. The Supreme looks up to the Major.
I won't even tag him in. He'll have to watch it and find out the answers. So that's I can at least get hit out of it.
Everyone
looks up to the
Major. Everyone has to.
So our big segment is the hotly anticipated If You Don't Joe Me By Now, which is, this is why I don't sing. I've got a little quiz. So I don't know how you want to do it. If you want to write down your answers and we'll do the answers at the end, or if you just want to shout out, first person who gets it gets a point. I will leave that to you guys. What would you prefer to do?
I think we're doing a podcast. I think we should use our voices.
Okay.
Cool. We have voices, we can shout.
Excellent. Well, I've got five questions. Some have multiple point answers and bonus points as well. I tried to keep it as simple as possible because I've got to try and keep track of it. So let's go with it. So this is a quiz about your head trainer, Joe Hendry. Yes. We've got five questions. First one to shout out gets a point. And as easy as that. I thought of the title before I thought of the concept, as you could probably tell. So first question, number one. Joe won his first championship in 2014, the SWA Laird of the Ring title, by defeating which Scottish wrestler?
This is great podcast content.
I know, it's not your start.
This is going to be terrible.
if we're going to go long, I might have to start giving you clues.
Yeah, please
clues,
do.
Clues would be good.
Okay.
That would be a good...
I should have really written down clues. So I'll go to this off the top of my head. So a former...
Give us their initials.
No, that's too easy. He often calls himself Scotland's best professional wrestler. He's the king of chat. He is Just Justice.
Jackie Polo.
There we go. 1 point, Fletch. This could go terrible.
Thank you. Right. It is.
So question two. This is probably the first and last time we do a quiz. Joe Hendry appeared on the ITV revival of World of Sport Wrestling.
He did.
Who is his first televised opponent for the promotion?
I don't think he's told us this yet, so how would we know?
He hasn't.
Did you not watch World of Sport at the time? It was incredible.
No, I know. Oh, no.
I watched it. I cannot remember.
All right, so clues. This opponent at the time was the WOS wrestling champion.
Probably a really good hint.
Yeah, it's a really
good hint. That's what'll be Justin Sizemore then.
Who won the title first?
Oh, no, that's not the same thing, because who won the title first was on the ITV special, where there was two champions. So, no, this is the actual television revival. So it's not Justin Sizem. He was the champion that ended the promotion. I don't know if that was his fault or not, but he was the last one.
There was only one champ.
So who did Justin Sizem beat?
You're testing my memory here, Billy.
That's why it's a quiz.
Yeah. Give me a second, I'll look something up.
No. Let's think of clues off the top of my head. If you're a fan of Discovery Wrestling, he faced the now Killian Dain in a last man standing match. He is part of the personification of destruction.
I know now. That's me on 2 points. Rampage Brown.
There we go. 2 points. Rampage Brown. The Rampage
Brown. Guys.
People listening to this and going, who are these clowns? There's so many.
We should be fine towards the end. The last three questions are the easier ones, the ones I didn't have to look up.
We're sorry, Joe.
What is the name of Joe Hendry's band?
Oh, I played with them. Hey.
This is on
years ago. Played with them. Oh, what was their name? It's this something.
Me and Matt can just sit back and watch this.
Just watch. No.
Matt accepted no points in this round. It's fine.
It's this something. It's. I know they've got like a song about burning.
I mean, it's true. Some of their songs are on Spotify. Yeah. I mean, earlier before.
So they were called the Dials. They were called the Dials.
Okay, that's not what.
And
I then thought.
They change. And no, they changed their name afterwards.
Okay.
That they changed it to is the one you need to get.
Yes.
Yeah, I know. And I'm thinking, what was the name? They had that song and they changed it.
Well, earlier Fletch lost his video, but he also was lost in...
An audio. Lost
there we
in
go.
Audio.
There we go.
My lord, that was bringing...
I'm very scared about the bonus point, which was name the lost in audio track used as his entrance theme initially.
Was it Burn It On or something?
No. I'm not even going to just wait. I'm just going to... It was Angeline. So we'll just move on from there.
Sorry, Joe.
We've got this one. This is going to be it. Everyone's going to get this one. Who is Joe Henry's tag team partner in Impact Wrestling?
Oh, it's
Grado.
It's Grado.
Yes, okay.
I was going to say Dalton, but I was like, no, shut up.
Yeah, that's Ring of Honor, Jim.
Yeah.
That's Ring of Honor.
Bonus point for his valet.
Katie Lee Birchall.
I'll give you that. It was Katrina, but Katarina, but I'll give you that one. Cool. Right, so everyone's got a point forward.
Sibling.
Oh, and it was always rumoured, but they never actually did anything to suggest it, which I sound like that I'm going, oh, that's a shame. But no, I didn't want to see it. Right, anyway. And the final question. This has got 6 points on offer. So everyone's in the game.
So whoever gets it right wins.
Well, there's six answers. So whoever gets them, that's 1 point each. In 2014, which is where I've seemed to be stuck in my research here, Joe Hendry made two appearances in WWE in segments with WWE superstars. Name the WWE superstars. 1 point for each name.
So I know both. Rosebuds.
Adam Rose and Rusev.
That's two for Fletch. Adam Rose, Rusev.
Or Miro, sorry.
Miro, yeah.
So there was also one, two, three, four more WWE superstars and managers involved in these segments.
And I'm trying to remember the photo. There was a photo that came out with all of them together. And
there was.
I mean, who would you generally find with Rusev?
Lana.
Well, it's Lana.
Oh, yeah.
There we go.
Damn it.
Then there's the Rosebuds.
Yeah, and the Rosebuds.
Becky Lynch.
I'm not counting the Rosebuds. They're a different entity. So who was part of that segment with Adam Rose on the Rosebuds? So it was Joe was one of the Rosebuds. He got accosted by... Oh, Joe is going to just tear you apart.
He is going to absolutely hate. That is why when you asked him, oh, could you maybe send something? He's like, no. Not for you guys.
Why right, did you set up this quiz, Billy?
Do you want me to put you out of your misery? I mean, Fletch has won. He's got 5 points. So,
let's give it to him. Just give it to him.
There's, I mean, you could... Mr. Manoval, Matt could actually pull back if he got all three. But so I'll just tell you your misery. During the segment with Adam Rose and the Rosebuds, he was attacked by Jack Swagger. Jack Swagger was accompanied by Zeb Coulter.
Yes.
There we go. That's just two more. During the segment with Rusev and Lana and Lionheart, but I wouldn't have accepted that as an answer. The segment ended when it was interrupted by the former United States champion at the time, Sheamus. And the look of your faces.
He was.
So that's the first and last edition of If You Don't Joe Me By Now. I don't think I'm ever going to do a quiz section ever again because that is when... But still, Fletch has won. Fletch Cassidy has won with 5 points. And second place is Major Matt Wolfe with 2. And Mr. Manoval ends with
1. I'm getting
1.
Sick of that finishing position now. I can only do so many second places to Big Fletch.
So not only is he our Twitter champion, I can't remember the name of the tournament, what did they call it? Survivor Series. Survivor Series winner. He's also the winner of the inaugural and final If You Don't Joe Me By Now. That went.
I'm so sorry, Billy.
There's no lost in audio. That'll be fine.
I would have done my research.
The Grado one, I mean, the first two were the hardest ones because the ones did research on and then about yesterday. I need to do three more. I'll just write them down.
I mean, were they the hardest 4 years ones old though? When that happened?
What? So,
I was very young, probably.
So next session will be the history of Joe Hendry and he will be showing off all of his championship accomplishments and who he's done and what he's done and who he's done, not who he's done. Definitely not that. That's I'll be honest, it didn't get released. Okay, so, well, that's...
Yeah?
I don't know that's one of those things you don't know what to say afterwards. so like I said several times, we're going to do big individual episodes with you. So this might be one of the shorter episodes. We'll do the social media plugs. There was one question before we could do all that I skipped because it was asked by Daniel Cherry and Bryce. Pretty much the same one. It's what it's like being a wrestling trainee during the pandemic, and how do you see wrestling going after the pandemic is subsided or over, hopefully.
How's it been? How's it for a trainee? Let's answer it first. Like, there's two questions in that. First one, what's it like? One, it's crap because you can't actually go to training most of the time. We're doing either a lot of it online, but on the other hand, it's again taking the, not focusing on the negatives, focusing on the positives. What can you learn? What can you do for your character? How can you get yourself over? Or what are the ways that could potentially get yourself over? Things like giving the platform, such as yourself, for this. So you've got to put yourself out there to do, so you can do quizzes that you'll do abysmally at, and get yourself out there on Twitter. So yeah, it's hard, but I think it's not as hard as it, you know, as it possibly could have been without these opportunities.
Okay, yeah. Anyone else?
For me, it's very much, we expected one thing, like you kind of get in and think you'll train for however long, and then when you're told you're ready, there'll be a show or a series of shows, or someone might want you. And then finding that actually there's nothing on to have to be picked for. And so, well, what, as Jamie said, you know, you sort of push yourself out there in any way you can. And, you know, I think wrestling, it's probably going to be like this for a little while. It doesn't look like 2020 is really going to end until 2022. So it's what can be done. I think wrestling's always gone through these stages where you maybe go through more of a realistic shoot phase, and then you move back into more heavy set character work. And I think lockdown is showing, especially for us, we've had to push characters quite a lot. And I think you're going to start seeing that in other areas of wrestling. Look at how WWE's writing has already been. I think most of us are going to say the writing has improved somewhat across lockdown, because you're having to push character again and sort of take it back to what got you into wrestling as an 8 or 9 year old. You know, those big characters that grab the attention first, and I think we're seeing a return to that.
Excellent. Anything to add, Fletch?
I mean, the guys put it perfectly. Just as a trainee and with all the lockdown and the Rona, we're doing what we're able to do. Not that we're able to do very much. We were back at training, obviously social distance and all that, for a little bit, but then the 2 week lockdown thing happened, and I have a feeling that's going to go on for even longer. So who knows when we'll be back at training at this point, or even back wrestling. So I think it's just promos from here until God knows when. But I'm not complaining.
Cool. So we're going to go for our big finish, which was suggested just today as of recording. I had to make Manoval familiar with the Backstreet Boys portion of Brooklyn Nine-Nine. There's four of us. So the host, I will kick this off. We've got four. Everyone familiar with the lines of the first verse of Backstreet Boys, I Want It That Way, just before we. Excellent. We'll go myself. Who wants to go second? I'll give you a choice, and then we'll work our way down there.
Sure, I'll do it.
Okay, so we'll work down the way. So it'll be Fletch, and then it'll be Manoval, and then Matt to bring it up. And then I will play.
It's a pity that it's on my phone now, because now I can only see you, Billy. I can't see anyone else.
I was going to say, you've also chosen the one line that I don't really know. I know the first two.
That's practice beforehand.
You've got the last one. You've got the hardest one. It'll be fine. Yeah. We'll work it out. Right. So, and then I will do the tell me whys, and you guys can take it from there if you know the rest of the chorus.
I would have done vocal warm ups if I had known that we were actually going to do this.
I know you thought it was just a threat, but no, this is happening. This is our big finale before you mean, knowing our luck, I'll do the first line and Zoom meeting will go, right, that's it, 40 minutes out. So,
fingers crossed.
We're all ready.
Has it not been the 40 already?
I don't know. It's still recording, so I'm just going to assume it's working. So we're just going to... Cool. Right, okay. Or the old Steve Austin. You are my fire.
Jamie.
This audio's gone. That's perfect timing.
No, but the video is still going, so anyone on YouTube is going to love this.
I know, and I just look like an idiot. Fletch, yeah. can you speak? Hello?
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 Yeah, your audio disappeared. Right, okay, we're going to try again. One more time. Take two.
It's really going wrong for me, isn't it?
I know. People's going to hear me sing twice now. You are my fire.
The one desire.
Manoval.
Believe when I say.
Woo!
I want it that way.
Tell me why.
Ain't nothing but a mistake.
All you guys.
I never want to hear you say.
Woo!
I want it that way.
Chills, perfect. Literal chills. Oh, okay. Where can we find you on social media? We'll start you, Matt.
So Major Matt Wolfe on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter.
Manoval?
It'll be Manoval Mister on Twitter and Mr. Manoval on Instagram and TikTok. You can unfollow me there after that. I don't blame you.
And finally, Fletch.
I think it's the same on everything. I think it's Big Red F Cassidy on everything, but I will be adding the word Backstreet to that after today. Just a heads up.
So I think that's completed the strangest episode. I don't know what we're going to call this. I was going to call it the Edinburgh Wrestling Roundtable, but we can't call it that because that's
out of the question now.
that suggests
the shambles.
The shambles. The shambles.
The one that may not make it.
The one that I'll quietly put out. Just not tell anyone. But that's wonderful. Thank you very much for at least humouring me with the worst quiz ever and the Backstreet Boy ending.
No, it wasn't the worst. It was the best. It was the best, not the worst.
Okay, that's your words. And we'll look forward to getting individual episodes with you guys in the future. Yes. And We'll have a lot more serious fun then. We'll speak wrestling and probably cartoons, except with Fletch, because I won't have known any of the cartoons that you watched, but at least there are guys in the same age. But yeah, thank you very much. A brief pause when I hit stop record, which is something I should stop saying, but you know, this is the shambles episode, so I'll say it, and then we'll have a wee debrief and cringe our own singing. But yeah, thank you very much for joining me.
Thanks
Cheers, thank you very much for having us.
Thank you very much.